Mary has the most unique relationship with God in history. She is the daughter of God the Father, the mother of God the Son, and the spouse of the Holy Spirit. She was the first disciple in the church to welcome Jesus into her life, and she always remained close to her Son throughout his life, suffering, death, and resurrection. It is no surprise, then, that the mother whom Jesus loved so dearly chose to take her body and soul into heaven at the end of her earthly life, to share in his glory and live as a royal citizen in the kingdom of heaven. So, to honor our mother in the new order of grace, the church has always marked the Christian calendar with celebrations that recall the great works God has done for and through Mary by his grace. The Feast of the Assumption is basically the church's celebration of Mary's heavenly birthday. In 1950, Pope Pius XII infallibly professed that we pronounce, declare, and define it to be a divinely revealed dogma that the Immaculate Mother of God, the ever-Virgin Mary, having completed the course of her earthly life, was assumed body and soul to heavenly glory. The Church had always believed this historical truth for 2,000 years, but by confirming the dogma as a matter of faith for all Catholics, the Pope put to rest any doubts and corrected any errors which may have existed in modern times about the doctrine. His teaching was based on the lack of relics of Mary, her empty tomb, symbols of her assumption in Scripture, stories from the early apostolic tradition about the eyewitness of the apostles, quotes from early Christians, and ancient celebrations of the feast day in all churches. Pope Pius made it clear that Mary's assumption was not to be confused with Jesus' ascension into heaven. To ascend is something only God can do by his own divine power. To be assumed is to be taken up by God's power. Keep in mind the wording of the Pope's definition, that she was assumed body and soul into heavenly glory. The Pope was also careful not to indicate that Mary had indeed died before she was assumed, as this is not known for sure and is not important to the fact that she was assumed. In fact, there remains some difference between the Eastern churches and the Western churches as to how exactly it happened. The Eastern churches call Mary's assumption the dormition of the Mother of God. Dormition is a word for sleep and refers to her death. Many Eastern icons show the apostles mourning over a deceased Mary, with Jesus present, ready to carry her soul first into heaven. Then, according to the tradition, her lifeless body was taken to eternity 3 days later to be reunited with her spirit. The Western Church usually depicts Mary in art being taken alive, body and soul, at once into eternity, but some Western artists also portray her funeral as well. But remember the wording of the Pope's definition, that Mary, having completed the course of her earthly life, this leaves it open to interpretation as to whether she died or not. Some accounts say her assumption may have happened in Ephesus, where she lived for a while with St. John, but many confirm it occurred in Jerusalem. Today, the Church of the Assumption in Jerusalem, a famous place of her possible tomb, still stands as a place of pilgrimage. The Church allows for speculation about the particular details of the story. The fact remains that today we have all of the relics and tombs of every apostle and bones of many early saints, yet no church claims to have the body of Mary, because it isn't on earth. References to the Feast of the Assumption, being celebrated since the time of the apostles, date back to sermons in the 4th century. Today it is considered one of the solemn feast days of the Universal Church. It is celebrated by all Latin Rite and Eastern Rite Catholics in the United States as a holy day of obligation on August 15th. All of the Eastern Orthodox and smaller Eastern churches celebrate the Assumption around this time of year as well, and many of their church buildings are named after the Assumption, especially in Russia. The Church also commemorates the Assumption as the fourth glorious mystery of the Holy Rosary, followed by the fifth glorious mystery of Mary's crowning as Queen of Heaven. Even many early Protestant reformers also believed in Mary's Assumption, such as Martin Luther, who stated, "There can be no doubt that the Virgin Mary is in heaven. How it happened, we do not know." The Bible tells us that Jesus was the first to enjoy the resurrection. But there are other holy people in Scripture who have not yet experienced the resurrection. Nevertheless, they were given the privilege of being assumed bodily by God. The books of Genesis and Hebrews tells us that Saint Enoch was taken bodily by God. And in 2 Kings chapter 2, the prophet Saint Elijah is said to have been taken bodily into heaven. The letter of St. Jude also describes how Moses' body was protected from the devil by St. Michael the Archangel, a story which comes from a book called The Assumption of Moses. Mary's assumption is connected to the fact that she is the new Ark of the Covenant, who was sanctified to carry the Word of God in the flesh. The old Ark carried the Word of God in stone, and no unsanctified man could touch it. In Revelation chapter 11, St. John sees this old Ark in heaven, but immediately following in chapter 12, this image transforms into the figure of a woman with a crown of 12 stars carrying the child Jesus. She is clothed with the sun and stands on the moon, both heavenly symbols. And she escapes the devil in dragon form, to be taken by God to a place where she will dwell in peace. The early church always saw the woman as a symbol of Mary, the new queen mother of the new Israel, who was taken into heaven. The ark was a physical holy vessel which carried the presence of God. Mary was a physical holy vessel who also carried the presence of God. St. John sees both the old ark and the new ark physically in heaven. Psalm 132 foreshadows the fact that both Christ and Mary are in heaven. Arise, O Lord, and come to your resting place, you and the ark of your might. Another Old Testament story that hints at the assumption of Mary is in 1 Kings chapter 2. It tells of how King Solomon bowed in reverence to his mother, Queen Bathsheba, and placed her on a throne at his right hand. In the Davidic kingdom of Israel, the mother of the king was considered the queen of the nation, since the king might have several wives in those days. Thus, the people of Israel looked at her as a queen mother who could intercede to the king on behalf of the people. In this biblical model, the new Israel of the church sees a foreshadowing of our permanent queen mother Mary, who intercedes for the kingdom of Christ at the throne of God. Psalm 45 symbolizes this. At your right hand stands the queen arrayed in gold. Mary is the new Eve, who, like the old Eve, was preserved by God's grace from original sin. Unlike the old Eve, Mary always remained obedient to the will of God, and therefore, being sinless, did not undergo the effects of death as a consequence of sin. Jesus and Mary are the two exceptions to the scripture which says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God," which was simply St. Paul's comparison between the faults of the Jews to certain Gentiles. The fact that Mary was so closely united to her son shows us the inseparable bond they shared together on earth, a bond that continues into eternity. What God accomplished for Mary will be done for all the faithful, as we too are promised to be taken up to wear the crown of righteousness and sit on Christ's throne to live and reign with Jesus as children of the Almighty Father in his kingdom. Mary is the best image for the destiny of the church.